environment, or I'm going to make a difference on redistricting, or I'm going to make a difference on fighting these efforts to disenfranchise minority voting communities. But I'm going to look for organizations where I can, you know, play a role. I'm going to walk precincts. I'm going to make phone calls. I'm going to organize. I'm going to get involved with a group that's already out there. There are innumerable ways for people to be involved, and being involved is empowering. It's a way of fighting the kind of overwhelming nature of what this administration is doing and how much it is threatening many of the values that we cherish.
It is so dramatically daunting to see the harm that they're causing and the harm that they're planning. So thank you for those remarks. I have one more question, and I know our time is limited. I want to ask you, assuming that let's assume on the optimistic side or the hopeful side that the Democrats are able to take back the House and the Senate. That is my personal prediction that will happen, and I personally will do everything I can as a citizen to make that happen. But could you give us kind of a list of the legislative work you think that you all hope you can do once you take that majority?
Sure, and that's a very important question, because I think that what will be key, frankly, to our success in the midterms and beyond is giving people the reason to turn out and vote for Democrats, not simply against what the president is doing. And I think the key to that is to recognize that we are going through a profound economic transformation in this country. It began with globalization. It's continuing with automation. And it means there's going to be enormous disruption in the workforce. And there are people who are going to lose their job through no fault of their own and struggle to find one that pays just as well. There are parts of the country that have fallen behind and likely will fall further behind if nothing is done to help them. And I think this new economy that we're entering isn't going to look like the old economy where people work for the same company their whole life and had a pension with that company and had healthcare benefits through that company. I was very struck when I went to speak at Penn a month ago, and I got in an Uber afterwards, and the driver said, "Oh, this is my lucky day. I just got off work, and I live near the airport, and you need to go to the airport, and I can make some money on my way home." And I said, "You know, I'm struck by what you said, because you didn't just get off work. You just got off one work, and now you've started a second work for the day." And that may be what the future looks like, with people doing multiple jobs. But Uber is not going to be paying them a pension, and Uber is not going to be paying them health benefits that are adequate to what they need. And if you have one or two or even three types of work during the day, or you go from one type of work to another through the course of your life, you're going to need health care that you can take with you. You're going to need a pension system that goes with you wherever you work. And so I think Democrats need to be offering this. The portability of health care, the portability of your pension, a chance to be given a lifelong education so you can be prepared for the workforce, however the workforce changes, ways to make America prosper, every community prosper, every family prosper. That's what I think Democrats need to be offering and talking about.
Sounds like a great plan, sir. Sounds like a great plan. Well, listen, as one citizen involved in politics for most of my life, I just got to tell you this. I was an Art Linkletter kid, and you remember that show in the afternoons?
I do.
And I was, my mom talked them into bringing St. Catherine's School, and so I was one of the four kids. And my question to Mr. Linkletter was, because today the kids get to ask a question of art, and my question was, Mr. Linkletter, which political party do you belong to? I think I was in fifth grade.
Oh, my God.
And he
must have given him a heart attack.
Oh, the guy was, he was a very bright guy and a very friendly man. He winked and he said, "I'm a Baptist." That was the answer. Okay, but
that's funny,
and then we went to Farmer's Market and had a great lunch. It was quite a day for a kid from Rialto. But as somebody who's been involved myself personally in civic affairs since the day I embarrassed Art Linkletter, I just want to thank you for your service. I want to thank you for your leadership. I want to thank you for your thoughts. This has been a wonderful interview. I'm going to have one more question. sometime in the summer, as we get closer to the midterms, I hope we can welcome you back for perhaps a longer discussion, although this one was perfect and wonderful. So I hope that we can continue to have a dialogue with you, because you're one of the leading and if you will, shining lights of our governmental system. And we so deeply appreciate your leadership and your thoughts.
Well, thank you very much. A pleasure to join you, and look forward to a repeat engagement.
Absolutely. Well, that was a great interview. I mean, I just really enjoy him, and
yeah.
I'm a big Adam Schiff fan. When I shifted to the question of existential conflict with the gods of the Greeks, did you think he answered correctly?
Yeah, sure. I think
no,
he's
got. No, let me give you all some context on that. Carl's a really busy guy, and he's got a lot of balls in the air. And thank God he's going to get a little bit of time to do a little bit of travel. So during the interview,
no, I'm going for business there too. It's crazy.
He was setting up some elements of this trip he's going to take. So that was a tease. That was a joke.
Okay,
we
gotcha.
Did not go into existentialism.
Yeah.
This was for me one of the best moments I've had in the campaign for Ernie Powell. Any comments or thoughts, Carl?
You know, I just am thrilled that he agreed to do this. We'll be having a written form of this also in the weekly April 26th issue next week in Pasadena Weekly. But the thing is that I found it remarkable. I'm sitting here going, wow, you know, this guy, in my mind, could be the next president.
Oh, he's so calm and steady and thoughtful.
Yeah.
Yeah, I want him to be. I mean, let's just put it that way.
Yeah.
I also want to indicate that that in my apartment, I have pictures of me on Art Linkletter, so we're going to start a sale of those as a fundraiser for the campaign with Ernie Powell.
Just as long as you hide the rest of the special photos of yourself.
Yeah, well, my lawyer will call your lawyer, sir.
Yeah.
All right, I thought it was a great interview. I thought he was. I mean, he is a very thoughtful man. I like where he is, but I agree with you. I hope he goes to bigger and brighter places.
Yeah.
There's that special little apartment complex called the White House. And I'd love to see him there.
Yeah.
So let's talk about future shows. We're going to go back to probably every 2 weeks
for
the campaign with Ernie Powell. We typically don't talk to elected officials. On our next show, we're going to have the guy that's running the lawnmower outside the window. And then after that, we'll probably be talking to folks, good folks in D.C., like from my organization, Social Security Works. We've had Nancy Altman on in the past. We've had Alex Lawson on, who are very insightful and who know the lay of the land in D.C. So I'm looking forward to this next chapter for the campaign with Ernie Powell. I want to thank David, our technical person, and Carl, our overall producer and the creator of this amazing enterprise. Radio Titans. Any other comments, my friend?
You know, I'm just going to throw this out there. Folks, if anybody has a wish list of people that they'd like to see Ernie speak with, we've pulled off some amazing things like Congressman Schiff and with Barney Frank, Ed Asner, just incredible people. Both. So if you have any ideas, contact Ernie. And I'll do my best to make it happen.
Should I say what my email is?
Sure.
Ernie,
absolutely.
It's Ernie1014. That's ERNIE, followed by the numbers 1014 at sbcglobal.net. Shoot me an email, and we'll all consider if you have a recommended guest. We typically want to interview citizen leaders involved involved in social change. But once in a while, we're lucky enough to get somebody like Mr. Schiff. And so, any idea you got, we'll look at it. But again, we're going to have the lawnmower guy on next, and then we'll see where we go.
All right,
Dave, Carl, happy travels, and upward and forward, my friends. Thank you all.